this time, we would like to begin our commemorative conversation with distinguished persons who knew, worked, and or supported Robert F. Kennedy, and some who were with him right here 50 years ago. One of the persons that were with him right here 50 years ago was Dolores Huerta, a labor leader, civil rights activist, who has received numerous awards for community service and advocacy for the rights of workers, immigrants, and women. She's president of the Dolores Huerta Foundation, which is a nonprofit organization that organizes community groups to pursue social justice. She advised and supported Robert F. Kennedy during his 1968 presidential campaign. So Dolores, I'll ask you to take one of your chair. No, wait, have you take a chair? See? Next, there's another person who was actually here with Robert F. Kennedy 50 years ago, and that is Paul Schrade. So we're gonna ask Paul Schrade to come up. Paul was a former director of the United Auto Workers in California. He was a close associate of RFK and an aide in his bid for the 1968 Democratic presidential nomination. He supported RFK as a labor advisor and as an advocate for civil rights. Then, the next person, I was looking to see if Rosie Greer came tonight, but I guess he did not. He had emailed to say that he may not make it. So with that though, there are two other distinguished persons that we would like to invite to be part of this commemorative conversation. One of them is Peter Edelman, who is a professor of law and public policy at Georgetown University Law Center, where he teaches constitutional law and poverty law, and is faculty director of the Georgetown Center on Poverty and Equality. He is author of Searching for America's Heart, RFK and the Renewal of Hope, and worked for Robert F. Kennedy as a legislative advisor, and met his spouse, Miriam Wright Edelman, Children's Defense Fund, while visiting the impoverished areas of Mississippi with RFK. And then would like to invite Jeff Greenfield, who is an award-winning television journalist and author focusing on politics, media, and culture. He is the author of, or co-author of 13 books and numerous articles in many well-known publications. During the course of his career, he served as a senior political correspondent for CBS, a senior analyst for CNN, and a political and media analyst for ABC News. He served as a speechwriter for RFK. So with that, I'd like again to say welcome to all of our distinguished panelists here. And my first question is going to be directed towards Dolores and to Paul, who were right here again, as we noted, 50 years ago, celebrating RFK's presidential California primary victory. Before asking the question though, what was it like being right here 50 years ago in the midst of a lot of hope and excitement? Let's take a look at a video clip that was taken right here 50 years ago during the victory celebration. This will not only will give us a feel of the hope and the excitement, but we will see and hear RFK thanking Dolores Huerta, Rosie Greer, would have liked to point out if he was here, and Paul Schrade. And the video is a little grainy, and we're gonna lose the volume momentarily in a couple places, but let's watch it.
And Bert Corona, who also worked with him, and all of those Mexican-Americans who were such supporters of mine. And Dolores Huerta, who is an old friend of mine and has worked with the union, to thank her and tell her how much I appreciate her coming tonight. We have certain obligations and responsibilities to our fellow citizens, which we've talked about during the course of this campaign. And I want to make it clear that if I'm elected president of the United States, with your help, I intend to keep that. I want to also thank all my friends in the black community. Who made this campaign. Voting today, I think, really made a major difference for me. I want to express my appreciation to them. To my old friend, if I may, Johnson is here. And to Rosie Greer, who said that... He said that he'd take care of anybody who didn't vote for me. In a kind way, because that's what we are in our country. Smile. Yeah. And I want to also, if I may, just take a moment more of your time to express my appreciation to Paul Schrade, who, from the UAW, who worked so hard, and all the other members of the labor organizations and members of the labor union. I'm very grateful to him and for what he's done and the effort that he's made on behalf of the working man here in the state of California. I'm very, very appreciative.
Okay, so Dolores. Paul, what was it like being here with all that excitement?
Well, it was very exhilarating. I mean, everybody was so excited. We had farm workers. Come down from Delano and other parks when we got contracts and flooded all of East Los Angeles and South Central, setting up precincts to get out the vote. And it was great because we would go to a house and we would ask people to be a precinct captain to get the vote out. And about after 2 or 3 doors, we would say yes. So we'd give them a picture of the senator and they would put it in their window. We'd take a picture of the person and then we would jump to the next precinct. And so that way we were able to set up a whole bunch of precincts very, very quickly. And so when we knew that so many people had come out to vote that they actually had to hold, they had to close some of the precincts early because everybody voted. We don't see that in today's world, right? And I mean, the excitement was just, you could actually touch it because everybody was just so joyous because, you know, the reports were coming in, that everybody had voted and that the senator was going to win.
Paul, what was it like being here 50 years ago?
Well, this room has turned beautiful to me as a result of getting rid of the embassy ballroom. Although it was beautiful that night because it was a tough, hard fight that Robert Kennedy made against Gene McCarthy. And so that night, this was the embassy ballroom. There were about 1,500 people. The fire department had dropped its restriction of 1,000. But there was another 1,500 people in the ambassador room downstairs from here, which is where we're heading before we went through the pantry, with mostly Latino voters. And as Dolores pointed out, we were quite concerned, or Frank Mankiewicz was quite concerned, because in the afternoon, information was coming out that many precincts in the Latino community and the black community, the polls had closed mid-afternoon. And as Dolores has said, and I always have said, that was because of the kind of person Robert Kennedy was. He was able to go to blacks and whites in South Africa, go to Mississippi and see the hunger of black children starving, and come to Delano to meet with the farm workers and take on their cause. So that room that night was a beautiful room because all of those things that Robert Kennedy was doing came to fruition as he became our candidate for president.
I think Peter wants to say that Jeff was here that night.
Allow me to introduce politics to this discussion. Upstairs in the senator's suite, when it became clear that he was going to win the California primary, but by not as much of a margin as his people were hoping, the real conversation was what next? Because other than New York, that was the end of the primary season. It wasn't like today. The big states, most of them were all in the hands of party leaders or bosses, most of whom were strongly inclined to Vice President Humphrey. And so the question was, now that the primary season is over, how does the senator move? All of the TV analysts were asking him the same question. How are you going to get these delegates loose? Roger Mudd said, are you going to squeeze them? And Bobby Kennedy said to him, Roger, your language. He was in a very buoyant mood. Now, we're not going to get into that at this point, but what I want to say is that the celebration was tempered by some very hard political judgments, that there was a very difficult road ahead.
Okay. So, with that, my next question, which is kind of a coupled questions, I want to first direct it to Peter, and then perhaps to Jeff, and then back to Dolores and Paul. But before I ask those coupled questions, which are, what were they reaching for, and what did they want? Let's take a look at two video clips, very brief video clips, that show people reaching out to RFK. RFK is reaching out to them. They're running after him. He's in these slow-moving, topless cars standing up, and people are running towards a car, and he's reaching towards them and all of that. And so I wanted then just to show these two short little clips that illustrate that.
I am announcing today my candidacy for the presidency of the United States. I come to you today. Having been a campaign manager before, that 90% of the talk was done by men and 90% of the work was done by women.
Peter, what were they reaching for? What did they want?
They wanted
They wanted
Robert Kennedy, and they wanted what he was talking about. The issues that we had that were tearing us apart as a country. They wanted peace, the end of the war in Vietnam, and they wanted that all the people who were coming, we saw all races in that clip, because they really wanted everybody to be part of our democracy, that no one should be left out. And he was saying that everywhere he went. Jeff, you maybe had a better sense of it every day because the first part of the campaign, I was in Washington and I went on the campaign later on. But Thurston Clark has written a book about just that, the campaign, which is quite, made some things, and I know a lot about it, that made it even clearer that no matter where he went, whether it was in an African American or a Latino, but also rural white people, people in Kansas, the very first speech that he gives when he comes out from having announced, and he was saying to people who didn't necessarily find these things. There was a great deal of commitment about ending the war. That was certainly true, although the country was very divided, but the people who were there for him. But then he was always talking about poverty. He was always talking about race to people, to audiences that were completely white.
What was he doing? I mean, he was really on a mission. This was about being president, but it was also about education of everybody in our country. That's what's going on when you see people in the streets as he drives along, and then when he was actually speaking in whatever area, place that it was. That's what it was about.
Jack.
Just to underscore what Peter said, the pictures you saw, the pictures we generally see, are these enormously enthusiastic, almost frenzied crowds in the inner city along in urban neighborhoods. It got to the point where the staff was concerned because they were pulling him out of the car. Mm-hmm. He was in danger from his most loyal supporters. But they were also worried that back home and on the television sets, this might not look all that appealing. It looked more almost disruptive. So the other thing that the Kennedy campaign did, as Peter said, was to go into some places deep into rural America on trains, whistle stops to Indiana and Nebraska. He went through South Dakota, I think, at once. And he would talk to people who were not receptive to the message of social justice necessarily. But what we found out was these people who were in some ways hostile to the anti-war movement, resentful of the civil rights issue, were saying about him, you know, he just might be tough enough to fix this. And we did find out later that some of those Indiana voters wound up voting for George Wallace, which may seem unthinkable. But what these voters were looking for was somebody to get hold of what seemed to be a country out of control. And if Bobby Kennedy was going to do it with jobs programs and massive investments in a community and putting power back in the hands of these people, okay, we'll buy it, because he's one tough guy. Mm-hmm. Nobody ever said about Robert Kennedy, no matter how much they might have disliked him, that he's not tough enough or knowledgeable enough to be president. Mm-hmm. He was 42 years old.
Dolores, what were they reaching for? What did they want?
Pardon?
What were they reaching for? What would they want? All of those.
I think people wanted somebody that could listen to them sincerely, not just to pander to the people, but that, you know, he had that very sincere, I call it authentic, very authentic, when he spoke to people and you looked at Robert and he was listening. He was listening, and I think that's what people felt, that there was somebody that really cared about them, somebody that could understand them, somebody that was willing to help them. And I think that really embodied. And so, you know, like when he was in Delano after Caesar's Fast, and you'll remember, some of you that were there, Peter and Paul, when people, all of the farm workers were shouting, Kennedy for president, Kennedy for president. That's before it had become public that he was going to run. But there was something else there that was going on, because of course, many of these farm workers had never seen Robert Kennedy before. Yeah. That was the first time that they actually saw him. And when he spoke, you know, because we had a few thousand people there, there with Caesar and Robert. But when he spoke, I mean, he touched people. He touched people immediately. And I was with Paul, and I were at the Auto Workers Convention. Remember Paul when he spoke at the Auto Workers Convention? And again, he didn't pander to the auto workers. You know, he was talking about that we should not be the arms merchants of the world. And there were a lot of people there at the convention that were in the defense, in the defense industry. So I guess he was speaking truth, and people knew that he was speaking truth. And I think that's you could sense the integrity that the man had and the vision. And I think that's why people were drawn to him so deeply. And I would just say, with the experience that he had with us, with the Farm Workers Union, I remember when we were in New York City, and a group of the farm workers got arrested. They were picketing at the Hunts Point Market, where all the produce markets. And so we had about 40 farm workers that were arrested. So I called the senator's office, and I said, we've got all these farm workers that just got arrested. And he said, don't worry, we'll send somebody down there to defend them. And I mean, and well, Peter was often the recipient of all of the phone calls that we had to make. Every time that we needed the senator's help, we would call Peter. And of course, Peter would make sure that we got through to the senator. So it was just having this very powerful person that you could count on, and that you never felt that you were being a pest or that you were taking up his valuable time. Because whenever we needed something, we would call, and yes, we would get the kind of help that we needed. I mean, who does that in today's world? And I can just say, like, for our congressperson that we have, Senator Kevin McCarthy, the majority leader of the Congress, they won't even open up the door so you can have a meeting with them. Mm-hmm. I mean, so this is what made, I think, Senator Kennedy a remarkable human being, because no one was too high in position, or nobody was too poor that he couldn't attend to them.
Paul, let me give a couple of shout outs here, because I see Monica Garcia here, who was the chief of staff for the school board member from here, and she gave us great leadership and built a strategy to get to school because we had some problems in the school board. And also to Judy Baca, friend of the family. I was at a meeting here because the school board member at the time had to be out of town. He said, there's a group getting together talking about artwork for the ambassador. And the announcement was, 1,600 letters went out to recruit artists to do work in the school, and some of them did. And I said, what about Judy Baca? Did she get a letter? Who's Judy Baca? Mm-hmm. Here, the person who gave us the LA River Project and so many other good things in the city. And these murals are so outstanding about Robert Kennedy and the history, the social history of our country, and all the hands up here that went out. Mine's up there near Bob's right elbow, or left elbow. And when Kathleen Kennedy came here for the first time, she was the first person in the family that supported the school. And she looked up at that, I see you're holding up my father, right? And so we've had really good emotional movement moments in this space. Her daughter, Megan, was with her that day, and Megan just sort of disappeared off to the side. When Megan came back, she said, I just talked to the athletic director. What about? She said, I'm going to give a yoga class here for 100 students in this school. Here, a member of the Kennedy family had a yoga studio in West Hollywood, which is not really something that we would expect from a member of the Kennedy family, but she did such a great job here early on at the school. And I think that the other thing I'd like to say about this room, because it was such an important part of our victory that night. There were 1,500 people, as I said before, in this room. But when we tore down, actually got the order to demolish the Ambassador Hotel, which was again another struggle, there were three false ceilings in this room, pretty much at that level over there. And so we wound up with this beautiful structure, which it makes this library so great because you've got north lighting and south lighting on it. And it gave Judy an opportunity to have a real palette for the kind of work she did. Now, that night, I think I was more optimistic than most people, because Kenny O'Donnell called in as we were waiting up on the fifth floor to come down here. We got a call from Kenny O'Donnell, who said, I just got word from Mayor Daley's people in Chicago. Mayor Daley was tracking Hubert Humphrey for Humphrey and not for Bob. I've just talked to our people in Chicago, and they're going to be supporting Robert Kennedy. We got a call from George McGovern, senator from South Dakota. He said, not only did you beat in a big way Eugene McCarthy in South Dakota, but the Lakota tribe voted something like 69-2 for you against McCarthy. And this is another thing that we should understand about Robert Kennedy.
he actually dealt closely and directly with people, whether it was South Africa or Mississippi, with Peter and Marion. He would go to Watts here. He took the Watts Labor Connection Committee, which was a union, my union's project, where we tried to get union members to do something about their own communities, which is what Dolores is doing up in the valley, is getting people to do something in their own communities. We call them community unions. And Bob Kennedy went to Watts in the mid-60s, saw the Watts Labor Community Committee in action under Ted Watkins, now his son, Teddy. And he took that information back, that idea back to Brooklyn, and put together the Bedford-Stuyvesant Restoration Project with another community organization, both of them alive and well today, like the Farm Workers Union and like Dolores' Foundation, which is doing this same kind of work. So the spirit of Robert Kennedy was there, and I was optimistic about his winning. First of all, because Walter Reuther opposed me on supporting Robert Kennedy when he announced. Walter Reuther was my mentor. I left Yale University in a chemistry career to become active in the UAW. And so Walter was finally coming across because we were together that day opening up negotiations with McDonnell Douglas. We also, I think that Bob Kennedy had a way of campaigning that nobody else did. He was reaching out to people, and people were reaching out to him. And we needed that during that period. We had terrible rebellions in black communities and Latino communities. We had some organizing going on, but we weren't doing a really good job. And among students, I mean, he actually attracted and took on students saying, you know, workers in this country and poor people are doing your fighting in Vietnam, killing other workers, and yours got safe harbors here in these universities. And one in Kansas, after confronting students, they burst out in applause. And it was that kind of thing that Robert Kennedy had that was going to win him the election.
So let me ask, Peter, you my next question, which is, what should we be reaching out for today?
But you know, we have an enormous opportunity now. We don't have Robert Kennedy. So it's our responsibility. I mean, it's always our responsibility, the people. Talking about the fact that Robert Kennedy spoke out to people and went to where they were, where they lived, and what was that about? It was about empowering them. So that, yes, he was the leader, but it was really about taking in all of the marginalized and everybody owning a piece of this country. We have to do that now, of course, literally, without him. We don't know if ever there is going to be leadership. I hope there is someone like that. We don't know who that is right now. We don't know where. Who we have is ourselves. Mm-hmm. That is the heart. He would say the same thing from heaven. And look at what's happening now. I mean, this is a dreadful time, but look at what's happening in terms of people who are running for office, people. All kinds of groups that are movements, in effect, outside of the electoral process, but especially women who are running for office, and young people who are running for office. This is going to take back this country. Mm-hmm. They got a lot of money. Mm-hmm. We got the people. Mm-hmm.
So, Jeff, what should we be reaching out for today?
When Robert Kennedy died, one of his journalistic admirers, Jack Newfield, wrote the stone is at the bottom of the hill. And he was referring to the myth of Sisyphus, who in legend punished for his sins by pushing a boulder up a hill. And every time it got to the top, it would roll back again. And the premise is the stone keeps rolling back, but you gotta keep pushing back. I spent my life after Robert Kennedy died as mostly a political analyst, and you get a very kind of hard-nosed notion of what is and isn't. And I can't recall a more despairing time than we are in now. And that's partly because of root political reasons. The president who is moving in a direction as opposite from Robert Kennedy as one could imagine, is supported by a legislature, a Congress, that will not hold him to account. And it sounds uninspiring, I guess, but unless November produces a political reality in which some institution begins to draw lines, it's only going to continue this way. The idea of people reaching out for a more hopeful scenario is the other part, the parts that divorce from politics, the people all over the country trying to build institutions, trying to teach kids who need teaching. And the one optimistic piece of evidence that I found is a new book by a great journalist named James Fallows and his wife, Deborah, who went all over the country and found in pockets of small towns and mid-sized cities all kinds of things going on that give you reason to hope that, that seeds are being planted that will someday grow. But if you're going to look at this realistically, you're going to look at what Jack Newfield said 50 years ago. Mm-hmm. You know, the stone is at the bottom of the hill, and it takes an enormous effort to try to push that stone up again in the face of what we're facing.
So, Dolores, what should we be reaching out for today?
Well, we just saw the video where Senator Kennedy gave his last speech to the public. And I have been quoting his words. That part of the video is included in the documentary, Dolores. I'm a little advertisement here. It's a documentary about my work with the Farm Workers Union that Carlos Santana produced. And as I've been following the movie all over the country, the documentary, I point that out to audiences. And his words were, "We have obligations and responsibilities to our fellow citizens." And I have been quoting those words, reminding people that these were the last words that he said before he left us. You know, and I think that's one thing, as Peter was just saying, we don't have a Robert Kennedy as a leader. But that means that all of us have to take his place, and all of us have got to become involved. And with that same sensitivity and his values about reaching out to the poor people, reaching out to the working people. So when we talk about obligations to our fellow citizens, who are our fellow citizens? It's the immigrants, it's the DACA students, it's the homeless, it's the disabled, you know, people that have mental illness. You know, these are all the people that we have an obligation to. But hopefully, especially now with all of these remembrances, and I would hope that they would be taking place all over the country, to every single person in our country to say, we are the ones that have to keep Robert Kennedy's values alive. And Robert Kennedy, to your other question that you asked me, what did he represent? To me, he represented hope. He represented hope to a lot of people, and knowing somebody that would be there for us. And I would hope that everybody that remembers Robert Kennedy and the Kennedy family, because I would like to say that Robert Kennedy's values lived on in his children, and the work that Kerry is doing, and Joe Kennedy, and Joe Jr., Joe III Kennedy, and Max, and Robert Jr., and Kerry, and all of them that are doing this, they carry on their father's legacy. But I hope that all of us can do it by getting involved in activism, getting involved in helping others, getting involved in voting and campaigning. keeping the social justice politics alive. And that's what I hope everybody will do. Si se puede.
So, Paul, to you, what should we be reaching out to? What should we be reaching for today? What should we be reaching out for today?
Reaching out for hope, which Robert Kennedy gave us in that period of crisis in our country in 1968. We should be reaching out to the Me Too movement, to the Resist movement, to the student movement against guns. We ought to be reaching out to the DACA kids. We ought to be reaching out to those people who are in trouble in this country and doing what Robert Kennedy taught us to do, which we were doing anyway in our union, but he really taught many, many people that we got problems, we can solve them, and gave us hope during that period.
Okay. Any other comments before we leave this question?
I'd like to make one comment about Peter. When we wanted to get involved in the farm worker struggle, first of all, I got a call from Cesar one day in 1965 saying, we are being crushed by the growers in Delano. Could you give us a national media coverage? Fortunately, we were up in the convention of the AFL-CIO in San Francisco. Well, we organized a media group to go to Delano that day, and with Walter Reuther, and we had a whole day there, and we gave the farm workers movement some sort of idea of in the public's mind of what was going on there. And I think that, and just to talk about Peter a moment, when Robert Kennedy was part of the Agricultural Committee of the Senate, he was one of those who were supposed to come out for hearings in Sacramento and Visalia and Delano. We didn't know whether he's coming or not. Jack Conway, chief of staff of Walter Reuther, a friend of mine, called Peter and said, we need Robert Kennedy. Well, we got Robert Kennedy, and we got him a number twice to come to Delano, and thanks for your help, Peter, for that.
Well, I might just say, to connect with that, sorry, Jeff, because maybe it's of interest, what it was like for Robert Kennedy and Cesar Chavez to meet each other. It was really, there's one part that a lot of you know, and the other part which is really very sweet. The part that many of you know is that Kennedy arrives, there was a migratory worker subcommittee in the U.S. Senate. How about that? So the sheriff was talking, got there a little bit late, you remember that, I mean, everybody, you know. And the sheriff was saying to everybody that we don't do things like in Mississippi, we arrest people to protect them, he said. And Kennedy said, wait a minute, what was that? He said, well, we arrest people so that they won't be hurt. He said, you're saying me these people have not broken the law. They have not, there's no crime here. And the sheriff said, well, yes. It was about lunchtime. So Robert Kennedy said to him, well, Sheriff, it's just about lunchtime here. I suggest that you read the U.S. Constitution.
Right.
And during lunch. So that's the one we've seen in film and so on. The other part is that they went out kind of coming from, and it's just, you have to picture what this felt like and looked like. They walked out into the parking lot from kind of different directions, and they happened to meet each other, the two of them. And I was standing there, and they simply shook hands and started, and Dolores, were you right in the, okay, so the four of us. And you remember, Dolores, that first of all, they get in this immediately, this conversation. And I was a foot away, I couldn't hear what they were saying. But it gets to be these circles and circles and circles. And so it's like a piece of art with the, all the way around. And the point about that is, and this was something that I can't say for Cesar, but for Robert Kennedy, he had a kind of instinct when he had met somebody who was very, very special. And of course, he always believed one thing that was enormously important for him is that one person can make a difference. He said that over and over again, and he met one that day. And they were, from that conversation that we were there watching, they became friends forever. And as you said, Paul, I had the job which I greatly liked having it, which was to be the go-between. From the farm workers to labor or whatever in my mind. But anyway, just I want you to know that's how they met each other.
What I wanted to, Paul, if I may.
Let me footnote that a moment.
Footnotes to
after that, seeing Robert Kennedy actually not really talking with Cesar and Dolores, but feeling each other, we went out and walked the picket line at the DiGiorgio grape vineyard, which is the biggest grower in California. And I've been with presidential candidates before and other political candidates, but never walked a picket line with them. But we walked at DiGiorgio. At the end of the picket line, a young couple was there crying. Bob went over to them, "Why are you crying?" He said, "Well, we can't stand higher wages and healthcare that union is demanding of the growers." And Bob spent about 10 minutes with them telling them this is what Cesar Chavez was all about. He was going after the big growers. And they should have no fear of him.
Yeah.
I wanted to make sure, if in the context of this conversation, to mention one of Robert Kennedy's most remarkable traits that I think people don't point to, and that was his sense of humor on the campaign trail. Because the same instinct that Peter was talking about, of kind of a no BS kind of guy, talking about real conditions, also on a much more playful level, meant that he was not willing to do the pandering that most politicians do. And I'll just tell you one story. There were legion. You know how a politician gets to some place and they tell you, this is the best place in the world. Mitt Romney goes to Wisconsin and says, the trees are just right. So Robert Kennedy's at the Fresno Mall. And he says, people ask me why I ran for president. And I tell them, well, if I ran for president, I was going to have to go to California. And if I went to California, I was going to get to go to the Fresno Mall because, he said, once you've seen the pyramids and the Taj Mahal, what's left but to visit the Fresno Mall? And what he was saying was, you know this is nonsense, and I know this is nonsense, so let's cut the nonsense and talk reality. And he would do this over and over. On the whistle stops in rural America, he'd say, you want to know my farm program? Look at my breakfast table. All those kids drinking all that milk, eating all that toast. I'm a one-man price support program. You have to vote for me. And to me, it was the other side of the much more serious Robert Kennedy, who would say, I'm not talking airy abstractions. I want to tell you what life is like in the places I've seen.
Yeah. Okay, I just want to say something. When I was talking about Robert's children, you know, Kerry Kennedy has been campaigning in New York State to try to get the rights for farm workers that we have here in California for the last 14 years. And once New York State Legislature gets their act together, maybe we'll be able to pass some of this stuff. And I was also with Chris Kennedy in Illinois running for governor. And Joseph III, when they were fasting for immigration reform. He joined that fast in Washington, D.C., and actually fasted. And I can tell you that we would not have a school here right now had it not been for Max. Because when we were having such a hard time, I remember getting the superintendent of schools to sign on so we could have this beautiful school here. You know, Max came to the forefront, and then, you know, he confronted the superintendent of schools here in Los Angeles so that we could get this school built. So, I mean, it's just, I think, you know, if we can follow that legacy of the family, and with the courage that they have, and if we can get everybody to instill that type of courage of service, of public service, I think that's the way that we keep the vision alive.
Okay. So, Bobby Kennedy had a sense of humor, Jeff, as you noted, and I want us to take a look at another clip. And in this clip, you'll see in the very beginning him having a very light moment with Cesar Chavez. And then in a little bit later, you'll see him have a very light moment with his spouse, Ethel. And then a little later in the clip, you'll see a light moment between Ethel and Bobby Kennedy. And then at the very end of the clip, you'll see a light moment that he, Bobby Kennedy, had with his brother, President John F. Kennedy, and others in the room.
What happens, I get a very tough road ahead.
So I want to ask each of you to please share a lighthearted or a fun moment that you had with Bobby Kennedy.
Well, it's actually not one where I was with him, but I'll what you were just saying, Jeff. Somebody sent me quite recently a speech that Robert Kennedy had given in Eastern Oregon, all white, rural, and he goes in there, and there, up in the corner, there's a whole bunch of people who have signs that say Nixon's the one.
Yeah.
So he's talking and he sees it up there, and he stops and he says, "The one what?" And the whole place goes up. The one what? Anyway, that's a small one.
The first day I worked in his Senate office, I followed him where he said you should follow me to a hearing about education. 2 years earlier, the federal government, for the first time, had provided federal aid to education. Now, for a lot of liberals, that's the victory. Send a lot of money to the schools, we win. Kennedy had in front of him the head of the Office of Education. It was not yet a department, cabinet department. And he said, okay, in effect, what have you done with the money? How come, and he had a passion for what Frank Mankiewicz, his press secretary, called victim statistics. He said, how come the IQ of Negro kids, that's what the phrase was then, dropped between the third and sixth grade? How come when I go into a ghetto, the two things people hate most are the public welfare system and the public education system? So 24 hours after going to work for him, I said, oh, this is a different breed of cat, you know? This is somebody who drills down. He used a phrase in a speech, I don't know, Peter may have written it, Adam, we have to grasp the web whole. And that one moment was a kind of microcosm of how he thought. Don't tell me you passed a bill. Don't tell me how much money you're spending. What's happening?
Can I just add, also what reminds me to say about him as a senator, is that he did all the senator things, as we know, working on legislation and so on, and he also was kind of had, it's like there were two of them, and so he went to South Africa, he went to Bedford-Stuyvesant when they were working on all that. But there was a hearing when Ralph Nader was just starting out about auto safety. Nader was testifying before the Senate committee, and he was talking about the danger, the unsafeness of the cars, and there was a senator from Nebraska, a Republican guy named Carl Curtis, and he just kept interrupting, wouldn't let him, Nader, finish his sentences. And finally, Kennedy said, would you please let him finish his statement? You can ask questions after that. And Curtis said, well, it's the, and Kennedy said, the big words?
Now, this is an internal story. Paul, let me just tell you, because this is another one of those examples. There was some debate going on about aid to parochial schools. I don't remember the facts. And for some reason, the senator came out of his office into this rabbit warren where Peter and Adam and other people worked. And he's, I don't know if he acknowledges, but he's looking around at us. And he, in this debate about aid to Catholic schools, he sees Walensky, Edelman, Mankiewicz, and Greenfield. And he suddenly stops and he looks, he says, all I know is I'm going to heaven and you're not. do you remember that at all? It just always stuck with me that, you know, this is just not your normal political guy.
Paul.
I got a couple of lighter bones. 1956 convention in Chicago, we were supporting Stevenson and Keith Albert. I convinced Walter Ruhr to set up a room where we could meet, delegates could meet. He was against drinking, but he went along with it. We went up to that room, Walter and I, and Jack Conway, and we, coming out of the room was Jack Kennedy, Robert Kennedy. And they came up to Walter and said, Jack said, Walter, how can I get your support for the vice presidency? And Walter says, you've got to change your voting record, young man. Very certainly. The second time I had a lighter moment was in the 60 convention. I had been supporting Stevenson up until, it was close to convention time. And I changed my vote and support because Stevenson wasn't really campaigning. He wanted to be drafted. That was my analysis. So I went to Walter and said, look, I'm switching my position over to Jack Kennedy. And he called Bob Bright from his desk, because I was administrative assistant at the time, called Bob, and Bob said, send Paul back to California and organize those friends of his who are on the Stevenson delegation back in 56. Well, I spent 2 weeks with Robert Kennedy in Los Angeles at the convention. At one point, there was a great rebellion of the Michigan delegation. They didn't want Johnson for president. And Sophie Williams, the governor of Michigan, was trying to become that candidate. The convention came to a standstill. The Michigan delegation was off the floor. Bob came back to Walter's suite with a friend and said, Walter, what's happening over there with that Michigan delegation? You've got a lot of friends in that delegation and supporters from the UAW. And he said, well, it'll be okay. We've got a couple of vice presidents over there. A guy with him reached into his pocket, came up with a delegate badge, a Texas delegate badge. Bob pinned it on me and said, Paul, go to the convention. So I had a chance to make book with the Michigan delegation. They finally decided not to put up Sophie Williams as a candidate, but to vote no on the convention floor, and that's what they did. We solved the convention, but I thought that was a really funny moment when Bob said, Paul,
put that badge on me, go to the convention. And it was, oh, here's a fun guy.
Dolores, and then Peter.
I want to tell you a different kind of story, but.
It's certainly true that he had a wonderful sense of humor. One on me was, it's not one I was starting to, but we were just in the Senate for maybe 3 weeks or so, and I couldn't keep up. And so the mail was just piling up, and the phone messages and just piling up. And he came out of his office and he walked over to where we were, and he looked at me and he said, "Is your mind like that?" So, okay. This is the story I wanted to tell. We went to Eastern Kentucky in 1968. This is after we had been in Mississippi, and it was about hunger in Eastern Kentucky. And one of the places along the way was a one-room schoolhouse. Now, at the time, I didn't know what he said, talking to the students sort of one-on-one, but there was you may know that L.A., what do they call the L.A.? I can't remember the name. Anyway, it's a dramatic, John Malpete, is he here, by the way? He was gonna come, there he is. So John, I'm telling the story. John and I, we stood up in the front and asked all of these students who had been there in 1968 came back in 2004, 36 years later. And they were all there in these little desks. Whoever's making the John or whoever's asking it, what do you remember from that? And this man raises his hand and he says, "I was terrified. And Robert Kennedy came down, walked down the sort of the aisle there, and he got down on his knees and he said, whispered in his ear, which is why I didn't hear it then. He said, I'm really scared. And Robert Kennedy said, I know you're scared and it's going to be all right. And it just, you know, the children sighed. It was a beautiful moment. Right? Hi, John.
Dolores.
Well, we don't have anything very funny, but I can, one of the things that happened, and Peter might remember this, we had, Senator Kennedy came, when Caesar was ending his fast, so we had all of these thousands of workers at the park waiting for Senator Kennedy and for Caesar, because that one was Caesar was ending the fast. And when Peter and the senator came and they saw Caesar, and I think it was a very maybe awkward moment in some respects because, you know, Caesar was just finishing his 25-day water-only fast. He's very weak, and the senator greets him, and from there they were going to go to the park. But then the senator said he had to go to the bathroom, and we couldn't find any bathrooms that were open because everybody was at the park, right? And so we're running around Delano, going to all of the different homes of different staff people, but everybody was at the park, and so it was a harrowing moment, you know? The senator had to go to the bathroom, we couldn't find an open bathroom. Luckily, we finally had one of our attorneys who happened to, I think his wife, it was still the moment, hadn't gone to the park yet, so boy, that was a scary moment. And then when we got to the park, and they had made this great elaborate plans, and they were going to have, the farm workers were going to line up with the flags, and there were going to be two rows, and the officers of the union, we were going to be marching between these rows of red flags, right? Yeah, this is all been planned. And of course, Caesar was in a different space because, you know, he was very weak. So we start marching between these rows of flags, these red flags, and all of the farm workers just come crushing in. They all wanted to touch the senator, and I thought, oh my gosh, we're gonna crush the senator here. It was a scary moment, but it was also kind of funny because somehow they thought that people were gonna, you know, just stay and respect these lines. And of course it wasn't. All the farmers just came in, and it was a big old crush. And then we had to get people to go around the senator to make sure that he wouldn't get hurt. But I mean, it was just that, you know, people were so excited to see him. They just wanted to see if they could touch him.
I'll give you a 30-second story that Paul mentioned, that Robert Kennedy would often go to college campuses and tell them he was against student deferments, right? Because of who was doing the fighting. He would say to them, you say you're a generation that cares about justice, who do you think is going in your place? One day at one of these college campuses, and we're talking about thousands of people in an auditorium, and he's doing this, Kennedy loved to say to them, who's for student deferments? I'm against them. Boo! Let me tell you what. One of these moments, he said the following. He said, you know, when my oldest son is ready for college, he's going to get in because his father is a wealthy and powerful man. Ever heard a political figure say that about himself or herself? Acknowledging the fact of privilege. You know, there's a phrase that goes around a lot now, check your privilege. This is 1968 we're talking about.
I heard a story once, and maybe Peter or Jeff, you might know, that when they were having all of the trouble in the South on the segregation of schools, and that they were all kind of locked in, all of the Senator Kennedy staff and people that he had sent down there, and they were all in this place, but they were being surrounded by people that had guns. And it's the senator called them from Washington, and he made them all laugh. And I can't remember exactly what he told them, something about, I don't know what kind of friends you all pick or something like this, because they were all being terrorized by all of these people that had them surrounded when they were trying to desegregate the schools. But the senator called them from Washington and made them all laugh, so that, you know, they would kind of relieve the tension of what was going on in the South then.
Okay. So, okay. What I like to do is just to take a moment, and I like to acknowledge someone else that just came a little while ago to join us, and that is Roosevelt Greer. Mr. Greer was here 50 years ago as well, and very pleased that you're able to join us here this evening. Mr. Greer, if you don't mind, I don't mean to do something that would be kind of, that I would need to apologize for afterwards, but I would like to play a song of yours that I know was inspired in part by your experience with Bobby Kennedy. And again, if you don't mind, I listened to it several times, and I found it very moving, and I found myself very reflective. So it's just a few minutes, and I'd like us all to hear it together.
I used to stand up and say the world is a bad place. Then I'd sit back down and do nothing about it. Then one day, I met a man who had a purpose and a direction, and I joined him. That man is gone now, but there's still hope. But there's an awful lot of work to be done. And there are a lot of you that feel as I do. And if you feel this way, join me, help me sing this song. The words are very simple. They simply say,
people make the world what it is. Oh yes, what we give and how we feel. People and the books they read. The pity that we show and the awe of care. The load that we lift and the love that we share.
Else on television, which meant that 90% of the country was watching an evening newscast. so that when something hit, when Edward R. Murrow did Migrant Workers, Harvest of Shame, the country knew about it. We're now at a point, and I think this is true of the younger generation, but not solely, when a writer once called weapons of mass distraction are all over the place. And we're at a point now where we can get the entire, oh, this is the example. Somebody did a survey last couple of days that for every minute that the TV networks covered the fact that 6,000 people died in Puerto Rico during the hurricane, there were literally 200 minutes devoted to Roseanne Barr and her tweet. I don't know how this gets fixed, but I think unless we can figure out some way to redraw the eyes of the country on the kinds of things Robert Kennedy talked about, the effort's going to be way, way harder. It's not an optimistic message, but it's the best I can do in terms of, in the spirit of the guy I used to work with, trying to say what is.
Peter.
I thought that's couldn't be more important. You were asking also about what we ourselves.
Yes.
I'll just be very, if you will, mundane. The future of it is the young people who go to the school. Who's going to fix this country? Maybe that answer that question. Are the young people. That's true from generation to generation. They fall down sometimes and don't do what they ought to do, but this is the time, as I was saying before, of enormous opportunity, enormous challenge from what we're seeing, and people are waking up in a way, especially young people, but also women and others. So the thing that I do is that's what I teach. I teach in law school, and my definition of myself is helping to turn out public interest lawyers. Most of our students go into firms. That's not my business, not what I do. I teach about American poverty. I teach about getting as many young people in our law school to become public defenders, to become legal aid lawyers, to do one thing or another. And indeed, if they're lawyers in a private firm, that they should take the most, as much time as they possibly can doing pro bono to contribute something. So that's my mission.
Paul, your legacy.
I don't know if my nephew has shown up. Are you here, Max? Anyway, Max decided with a young friend of ours now who came to the door the other day and said, I'm 18 years old and I want to learn about organizing, and you're an organizer. Well, they went down to see Bernie Sanders today, dropped me off and hoped they would pick me up and take me home. But my point is, this year...
They're here.
They're here, okay. I also should let you know that Max saved my life on January 23rd, because I thought I'd had it. Had a worst case of flu. He took me to emergency at Cedars, and I was there 4.5 days. And for 2 days, I didn't know what was happening. I was really thinking I was going. And I want to thank him for that publicly. And also to recognize Jake, who's with him now, because he wants to learn organizing. He comes to the door and wants to learn organizing. Well, you have to do it to find out. And he's going to do it. He's on his way to Georgia to work in the governor's race down there. And to me, that's an indication that we're going to have to again rely on young people. We're going to have to, because not only of their needs, but also the problem of guns in our society. We've got to also consider the women who are out in the Me Too movement and the Resist movement. That's where the action is coming from, which we had during the Robert Kennedy campaign. It also has to do with people that Dolores is working with in the neighborhoods around, in the cities around Bakersfield. She's my greatest hero in terms of organizing, best organizer in the world as far as I'm concerned. And she helped organize this school. We trod this school when it was still here, or the master when it was still here, going after members of the school board and going after teacher support. And she did that kind of a job. And she is a good model, Jake, for you to look to. And so it's going to be relying on the people who are now in movements and encouraging them, particularly the women. We've got a person in the White House who's one of the great abusers of women, and we're doing nothing about that. The other thing we didn't do much about, until we got the property under control here. This property was owned by Donald Trump. He controlled it. The people on the school board and the students took that property away from him on an eminent domain claim. And that's why he's snuggling up to Putin to build that same building that he was going to put on here, that 125-story golden tower. He wants to build that in Moscow. I think he ought to move to Moscow and get the job done.
Dolores, your legacy in passing it to
To quote Reverend Jim Lawson, we have to dismantle the systems of oppression. And I think one of the best ways we could do that for our whole country is by changing the content of our educational system to include the contributions of people of color, starting with Native Americans, who were the first slaves, African slaves who built the White House, the Congress, and Monticello, and the Jeffersons, the governor's mansion in Virginia, and include with the contributions of the Mexicans. It's interesting, Bobby Kennedy said, my Mexican-American friends, right? In that talk that he gave his last talk. And like Trump, who's always attacking Mexicans, right? But the Mexicans and the Filipinos and the Chinese and the Japanese and the Indians, all of the immigrants that came and built this country. We've got to teach that starting with kindergarten or pre-kindergarten so that we can end the racism in our society. And so our children of color will have the dignity that they deserve to know what their people did to build the United States of America. And our white children, our Anglo children, will not be poisoned with white racism and white privilege, I think, number one. I think we have to teach about the labor unions and about the women's contributions and our LGBT community. That's got to be included in civic education, the importance of voting. I think we've got to start doing that. We've got to do it at the national level and include that, because we've got to make a big, giant blow to end racism and misogyny and sexism in our society. And I think if we don't do that, it's going to continue, and politicians can use that to divide people. And as I go around the country, talking to students and with the documentary, I'm going to again promote the documentary, Dolores, because a lot of the things that we talked about here, that footage of Robert Kennedy is in the documentary. People will really enjoy it. But I encourage students to get involved, to become activists, for people to run for office. And also to remind students that all of these movements are great. The Me Too movement, It's Time movement, the gun control movement, and Black Lives Matter. These movements are very important because they energize, they give information, but it doesn't change until we elect people to office that are going to change the laws. If we don't have people in office that will vote to change the laws, then nothing really changes. And I think that's the most important message that we can give out. And get civics back into our schools, and have teachers give credit to kids to go out there and knock on doors and help to get and do voter registration, etc. We could take our country back. And if you don't mind, I would just like to say to people what I say to them after the showing of my movies, where I speak to high schools and colleges. and some of you have heard this already before, but we'll do it again. And this is what I do. I ask a question. And the question I ask is, who's got the power? And I ask people to say, we've got the power. What kind of power? People power, right? And we can do it right now. But I like people that, let's, in the name of Robert F. Kennedy, let's shout it as loud as we can so that the KKK can hear us, the alt-right, the neo-Nazis, all of the haters, all of the homophobes, the sexists, and the sexual harassers. Okay, can we do it? Okay, we gotta shout loud. Okay, let's go. Who's got the power?
We have power!
That was very good. Let's do it one more time. One more time and louder. Who's got the power?
We have power.
What kind of power?
We have power.
Okay, can we go out there? Can we organize? Can we campaign to make sure that we get good people elected to office? What do we say? Se puede o no se puede?
Yeah.
Right, we can do it.
Okay.